Hi guys, it's Mrs. Lacefield here again, and I'm going to read to you Chapter 3 of Hatchet by Gary Paulsen. So what's happened last is Brian was flying to Canada to visit his dad, the pilot had a heart attack and died, and Brian's making a plan for what to do, because right now the plane's up in the air, and he decided that he would wait until the plane ran out of gas, and then he would try to kind of land it on a lake. So the plane just ran out of gas, engine sputtered and died, and now it's starting to go down. And it mentioned that Brian just threw up. It's going to mention it here in just a second. So we are on Chapter 3. We're going to find out what happens to Brian when he's trying to land this plane. Going to die, Brian thought. Going to die, going to die, gonna die. His whole brain screamed in sudden silence. Gonna die. He wiped his mouth with the back of his arm and held the nose down. The plane went into a glide, a very fast glide, that ate altitude, and suddenly there weren't any lakes. All he'd seen since they started flying over the forest was lakes, and now they were gone. Gone. Out in front, far away on the horizon, he could see lots of them. Off to the right and left, more of them, glittering blue in the late afternoon sun. But he needed one right in front. He desperately needed a lake right in front of the plane, and all he saw through the windshield were trees. Green death trees. If he had to turn, he didn't think he could keep the plane flying. His stomach tied into a series of rolling knots, and his breath came in short bursts. There! Not quite in front, but slightly to the right, he saw a lake, L-shaped, with rounded corners, and the plane was nearly aimed at the long part of the L, coming from the bottom and headed up to the top. Just a tiny bit to the right. He pushed the right rudder pedal gently, and the nose moved over. But the turn cost him speed, and now the lake was above the nose. He pulled back on the wheel slightly, and the nose came up. This caused the plane to slow dramatically, and it almost seemed to stop and wallow in the air. The controls became very loose-feeling, and it frightened Brian, made him push the wheel back in. This increased the speed a bit, but filled the windshield once more with nothing but trees, and put the lake well above the nose and out of reach. For a space of 3 to 4 seconds, things seemed to hang, almost to stop. The plane was flying, but so slowly, it would never reach the lake. Brian looked out to the side and saw a small pond, and at the edge of the pond was a large animal. He thought a moose, standing out in the water. It was all so still looking, so stopped, the pond and the moose and the trees, as he slid over them, now only 300 or 400 feet off the ground, all like a picture. Then everything happened at once. Trees suddenly took on detail, filled his whole field of vision with green, and he knew he would hit and die. He would die, but his luck held, and just as he was about to hit, he came to an open lane, a channel of fallen trees, a wide place leading to the lake. The plane, committed now to landing, to crashing, fell into the wide place like a stone, and Brian eased back on the wheel and braced himself for the crash. But there was a tiny bit of speed left, and when he pulled on the wheel, the nose came up, and he saw in front the blue of the lake, and in that instant, the plane hit the trees. There was a great wrenching as the wings caught the pines at the side of the clearing and broke back, ripping back just outside the main braces. Dust and dirt blew off the floor into his face so hard he thought there must have been some kind of explosion. He was momentarily blinded and slammed forward in the seat, smashing his head on the wheel. Then a wild crashing sound, ripping of metal, and the plane rolled to the right and blew through the trees, out over the water and down, down, to slam into the lake. Skip once, on water as hard as concrete, water that tore the windshield out and shattered the side windows, water that drove him back into the seat. Somebody was screaming as the plane drove down into the water. Someone screamed, tight animal screams of fear and pain. He did not know that it was his sound, that he roared against the water that took him and the plane still deeper down into the water. He saw nothing but sensed blue, cold blue-green, and he raked at the seatbelt catch, tore his nails loose on one hand. He ripped at it until it released, and somehow, the water trying to kill him, trying to end him, somehow he pulled himself out of the shattered front window and clawed up into the blue. Felt something hold him back, felt his windbreaker tear, and he was free. Tearing free, ripping free. But it was so far to the surface, and his lungs could not do this thing, couldn't hold and were through. And he sucked in water, took a great pull of water that would finally win, finally take him, and his head broke into light, and he vomited and swam, pulling without knowing what he was, what he was doing, without knowing anything. Pulling until his hands caught at weeds and muck, pulling and screaming until his hands caught at last in grass and brush, and he felt his chest on land, felt his face in the coarse blades of grass, and he stopped. Everything stopped. A color came that he'd never seen before, a color that exploded in his mind with a pain, and he was gone. Gone from it all, spiraling out into the world, spiraling into nothing. Nothing. Okay, that's the end of chapter 3. Pretty short chapter, but a really intense one as he's crashing the plane into the lake. Okay, next time I will read chapter 4 to you. I'll see you guys later.